My presentation will deal with data subjects' rights from the perspective of a lawyer in a broad research institute. I work in the University of Groningen, and I want to share and discuss with you two examples from my practice. My role in university is to advise researchers, especially I am very much interested in the alignment of data protection requirements with data management requirements and ethical requirements, not to overburden researchers and get good support for what I think is a shared responsibility. I'll say some more about that when I discuss the concept of the controller in the GDPR. I joined the ClientClick community 2 years ago, and I'm still learning a lot about your type of research. And my question is, can a discipline-specific network like Clarin help researchers to share good practices and to communicate with participants about sharing of data? So I hope that maybe you can also give a reaction on my questions in the chat. The first example, that's considered a request for of a participant who wanted to withdraw her consent. She was unhappy with the way the ethics board dealt the information about the research project, and she was unhappy with the role of the data protection officer within our university. So she filed a complaint, and she wanted not to participate in the research project. I try to say this in plain language, in the spirit of the GDPR. But then, when we considered this and consulted and talked with the researchers, they said, yeah, but we complied with the demands to pseudonymize the data as soon as possible. We separated the survey from the consent form. So we cannot identify who is this participant and what was her survey. And then, as Alexei explained, Article 11 says you don't need to store identifying information specifically for identification of a data subject. So the controller is not obliged to keep that information for the sole purpose of complying with the data subject's rights. Next slide, please. So some questions. Alexei also explained that based on Article 13 or 14 GDPR, you need to mention the rights of data subject. And what would you think? Should the researcher communicate in the information sheet with the participants, you have these rights under the GDPR, but keep in mind that we cannot do much with the request because we pseudonymize your data right from the start of the project. We are now considering this because we find in our university that it's something an issue for ethics, and something ethics boards really check is how is the information to the participant? Is it in plain language? Does it mention everything that they really need? Are they free to give their consent? So we are considering this. How transparent should we be? And maybe you have examples of how you mention these rights in the information to the participants? And do you see it as an ethical topic or a GDPR topic? Because in the GDPR, rights need to be practical and effective. And what we often see in information sheets is that there is a contact person, one of the researchers, say the PI. And that's effective because the PI knows about the research and can assess how can this participant be removed from the files. So that's a practical approach. Yet, is it a responsibility of the researcher or of the institution? Let's go into that issue a bit deeper. And I would like to see your remarks in the chat. This is a slide we use in training in our university for PhDs. The GDPR says the legal or natural person that decides about the means and the purpose of processing is the controller. And there's case law that says, okay, so it can also be both the legal entity, so the university, and the person. And that's very interesting. And in our university, we point at this shared responsibility. For instance, the institution has a duty of care to enable responsible research, like a secure working environment, training, guidance on how one should deal with a request from the data subject. But in the legislation on higher education in the Netherlands, it is the dean of the faculty who is responsible for research policy. So it's not at the central level, but more in the faculty level, closer to the practice of the research, that there is a layer of responsibility too. And in the law on higher education, it also states that the researcher has academic freedom. So the central board cannot say you should do your research in this way or communicate with the participants in this way. But the central university can stimulate that the researchers are supported to comply with ethical standards and research integrity. And Pavel mentioned the derogations for research. They're all under the condition that researchers comply with ethical standards. And as I'll explain with the second example, maybe it would be a very nice goal of Clarin as a community to clarify specific ethical standards or codes of conduct under the GDPR for how to deal with requests of data subjects, as mentioned in Article 40 of the GDPR. It would really help researchers that do research with language resources or voice recordings in universities elsewhere in Europe. Let's skip the fourth, that's the role of the funder, deciding on the means and having requirements on data protection as well, but not as important for now. The second example, that's based on a DELAT use case. DELAT is a community to share good practices for hearing and speech impaired research. There's an excellent, very good documented example, and Alexei also contributed to this, about voices of Polish children, heritage data that were stored in the language archive in the Netherlands and made findable via TalkBank. So now suppose that one of these children is grown up and comes to the language archive with the original audio files and saying, hey, this identifies me, so can I have my files removed? And then Article 11 in the second section says, with this additional information, indeed, the data should be removed. And then the question comes up, what's the role of the language archive? So again, who decides about the means and purpose of the processing? Do we have to, this is an topic I think we need to discuss more, especially for language archives. Do we consider an archive as an independent controller for reuse of the material and for archiving the material? There is some guidance of the European Data Protection Board that points in that direction and requires a data protection impact assessment to define what kind of safeguards needs to be in place for safeguarding the rights of the data subjects. Another approach, and that came up when we did a training session, is that it would be helpful to have a single point of contact for requests of the data subjects when these data are archived in another, under the responsibility of another controller. Next slide, please. So I come to my conclusion, and based on these examples, it would be really helpful to clarify responsibilities. That is a requirement also under the GDPR on how to communicate. Alexei mentioned that if you have not consent as a legal ground, but further processing in with legitimate interest, then sometimes it is required to have the information for the participants in a website. So it would be a good idea to publish these good practices and examples on a website of the Clarin, so other people can learn how these communication and transparency about the interests of research in this field can be explained to the larger public. Thank you.